Hello viewers, continuing our discourse on elementary crop physiology, and in this part we are going to study and understand physicochemical phenomena, especially imbibition, diffusion, osmosis and related processes. Let us appreciate that this part is dedicated to understanding of plant-water relationship. Basically, we want to know that how water is absorbed by roots and it is transported to the shoot, and how it is again transpired back to the atmosphere through leaves. This is referred as plant-water relationship, and it is generally governed by laws of physics. That is why it is referred as physicochemical phenomena. In this part, we shall learn principles of movement of water in soil-plant atmospheric continuum, and we shall also learn about physical processes, passive and active transport, with reference to role of plasma membrane and the energy relationships. Water molecule is one of the most important molecule on the planet Earth. We know that all the living organisms contain very high percentage of water in their body. The water percentage ranges from 90% to 95% of the fresh weight of the body, which is also true for the human body and the plant. The water molecule is H2O, and as we can see here that the hydrogen is a positively charged particle, whereas oxygen is a negatively charged atom. The water molecule joined together with the help of hydrogen bonds, which are cohesive bonds, and the water molecule form the water body through various type of cohesive bonds. At the beginning, we shall try to appreciate the word imbibition. Imbibition is purely a physical process and is takes place in dead wood. As the wood or any other adsorbent come into contact of water, the water molecules get attached to the surface through physical processes and then moves inside the body following the laws of the diffusion. Therefore, the adsorbent swells in size and a great pressure is generated through the absorption of water, which is called imbibition. The absorption of water by seeds before their germination is also a phenomena of imbibition. And this process of imbibition has been used to break very large rocks. In that case, we can greatly appreciate the importance and the magnitude of pressure being generated by this process of imbibition. When plant cells come into contact with water, with the external solution, there are two positions: that either the external solutions, the concentration is lower than the plant cells, or it can be higher than the plant cells. The conditions are referred as hypotonic or hypertonic, as the case may be. If the external solution is higher in osmotic potential, the plant cell or tissue will absorb the water, or if the external solution is lower in the osmotic potential, then the plant cell will lose the water from the tissues. In that case, the plant cell shows a breakdown of cytoplasm from their cell wall, which is referred as plasmolysis. The phenomena of plasmolysis can very well be observed under simple microscope, as shown here. Diffusion is a very general and a common process. The word comes from the laws of the kinetic theory of the gases, that the energy of the gas or the liquid will depend upon the number of molecules, their rate of mutual collision, and it is increased with the pressure, it is increased with the temperature, but addition of any other solute decreases the energy. The diffusion is the movement of molecules, and in the case of plants, as we deal with the water molecule or the water as a solvent, here we can say diffusion is the process of movement of water molecule from the region of their higher energy or chemical potential to the region of their lower energy or lower chemical potential. When this process of diffusion or the movement of water through semi-permeable membrane, as we have already understood that all plant cells are governed or covered by an outer membrane called cell membrane or plasma rima, and it interspersed inside the entire cell, the phenomena of diffusion is always through a semi-permeable membrane, and therefore the diffusion, when takes place through semi-permeable membrane, it becomes a specialized diffusion which is called osmosis, and that kind of diffusion is governed by Fick's law of diffusion, which is directly proportional to the energy difference and inversely proportional to the thickness of membrane. And when the sign of proportion is removed, there is a diffusion coefficient. This law is called Fick's law of diffusion and is applicable to the process of diffusion in plants. Therefore, we can define and understand that osmosis is a specialized diffusion through semi-permeable membrane. Here it is demonstrated that when the movement of water molecules takes place without any membrane, then it is a simple diffusion. But if the movement of water is controlled or governed or through a semi-permeable membrane, is called osmosis, as we can see here in two different cases. When the process of osmosis takes place, the phenomena of osmotic pressure comes into picture. Osmotic pressure is that pressure which is required to inhibit the process of osmosis, as here we can see in the case that a water molecule is being moved through semi-permeable membrane in case of three beakers or in the U-tube. Dear viewers, this is the juncture where we should appreciate that there are two set of terminology being employed in case of diffusion and osmosis. One set is referred as old terminology, and one set of terminology is referred as new set. In new set, we try to understand the movement of water molecule on the basis of energy consideration, chemical potential or water potential. And this is the correct as well as most adopted set of terminology in all modern books. And here we see the water potential equation is that water potential equation is a sum of turgor potential and osmotic potential. In the adjoining diagram, we can appreciate what is turgor. When plants absorb water from the external medium, it swells in volume, increases in volume, and therefore the cytoplasm exerts a pressure on the cell membrane. In turn, the cell membrane exerts a pressure on the cell wall, and therefore this pressure, which is exerted by cell membrane on cell wall, is termed as turgor pressure. This turgor pressure increases the water potential by addition in the osmotic potential. The osmotic potential in turn depend upon number of solute molecules. If number of solute molecules are more, in that case the osmotic potential is lowered. So we try to understand and appreciate the importance of the water potential equation. In this Hofler's diagram, we can understand that how turgor pressure can be calculated indirectly. By use of certain instrumentation and equipment, we can measure water potential and we can measure osmotic potential also. And by way of subtracting osmotic potential from water potential, turgor potential can be calculated as shown in this Hofler's diagram. Here we appreciate that by application of laws of physics, we can understand the movement of water from soil to root, from root to shoot, and from leaf to atmosphere, and we see here that this movement of water in soil plant atmospheric continuum is governed by an analogy that how an electricity flows in a conducting system. In a similar way, water flows in soil plant atmospheric continuum. The water absorption by roots is one of the most important part of plant life, because water is made available from the soil to the roots, and the root zone in which the hairs are, root hairs are maximum, the water absorption it takes place maximally. Then inside the root, the water travels through the epidermal system, through the cortex, through the endodermis, through Casimirian tube strips, and then reaches up to the vascular system. There are large number of theories to explain this kind of movement which is absorbed by the roots. One school of thought says that water flows through as a mass, and the water molecule in conjunction through the cohesive bonds moves inside the root in a totality, whereas other persons believe that there are certain salts which are absorbed by roots. They accumulate inside the pericycle, creates a negative water potential, and therefore there is a gradient is created, and the water moves from higher water potential to the lower potential up to pericycle and up to the vascular system. This is referred as the water potential gradient theory. Many people believe that there is a role of active absorption, that is some energy is involved while transporting salts inside the pericycle. Therefore, they also call it that the water absorption in root is a kind of active phenomena. But largely people believe that water is absorbed through passive mechanism, especially following the Fick's law or following the laws of diffusion. Here in this diagram, we can see the path of the water from root hair to epidermis to cortex to pericycle to endodermis and up to the vascular tissues like xylem and phloem. Some scientists, especially Munch, has created a concept of symplast and apoplast. As we know that in tissue there are living component as well as certain dead component. The movement of water takes place through living component as well as the non-living component. The movement of water on non-living component is referred as apoplastic movement, whereas the movement of water through living system or living component of the cell is called symplastic movement. And here, as we can see, that there are movement of water from epidermis to the endodermis to cortex to the pericycle up to the xylem tissue is the symplastic, and the surrounding walls, which are dead parts, the collenchyma, the sclerites, the sclerenchyma, they all refer to the apoplastic movement, where there is a totally physical adsorption of water, whereas in living component it is the absorption of water. Now the question arises that after reaching to the vascular tissues, or especially the xylem, which is the main tissue responsible for the upward movement of water in the shoot, how the water moves upward. This is still an enigma in plant science. When we particularly think the movement of upward movement of water in tall trees, however, there are various theories which explain that the upward movement of water takes place through the mechanisms described as ascent of sap. And one important theory of upward movement of water is called root pressure. Root pressure is generated through the water absorption by accumulation of salt in the xylem tissue inside the pericycle. And therefore, there is a continuous flow of water up to the pericycle and vascular tissue, and therefore it causes an upward movement. This root pressure has been demonstrated in the experiment of test U-tube toward a cut shoot, and we observe that the level of water rises in the U-tube, which shows that roots are exerting pressure, which is responsible for the increase in the level of water in the U-tube. Secondly, U-tube is also responsible for the phenomena of guttation. Guttation is also a sort of water loss from the leaves, but it takes place in the liquid form, whereas transpiration takes place in the vapor form. Guttation takes place through specialized water stomata called hydathodes, whereas transpiration takes place through the stomata. It is believed that guttation takes place in conditions where transpiration is inhibited. Therefore, guttation is altogether different than transpiration and is mainly attributed to the phenomena of root pressure. The another most important theory to explain the ascent of sap or the translocation of water in the chute is the cohesion tension theory. This theory says that the water molecules remain attached to the xylem walls by the way of cohesive bonds and therefore forms a continuous column inside the xylem vessels or tracheids. And there is a tension is continuously being created because the gravity of the earth pulls the water column toward the gravitational center, whereas the transpirational pull, it stretches the water column toward the atmosphere. Because of this cohesion and tension, the water continuously moves in the chute, and it probably explains that how the water column may move continuously in even long trees. Therefore, we must remember, however, that any physiological event, that is water loss, solute building, directly or indirectly causes water potential to become more negative with increased water gradient established from one area to the next, with influenced water movement. The most important thermodynamic property of water with respect to water flow in biological system is the water potential. Water will tend to move according to the law of thermodynamics in direction from less negative to lower more negative water potentials. Now we are going to understand the next step of the water relation, that is transpiration. Transpiration is also a kind of evaporation. Evaporation is from the physical surfaces, whereas transpiration is from the biological surfaces. Transpiration is of three types: cuticular transpiration, lenticular transpiration, and stomatal transpiration. The most of the transpiration takes place through the stomata. Stomata are the tiny apertures on the leaf surfaces. What is interesting that for photosynthesis, the carbon dioxide is absorbed through stomata and the water is also lost through the stomata. This dilemma is referred as water photosynthesis syndrome, that either plant can photosynthesize or it can transpire. If stomata are closed, it is at the cost of photosynthesis, and if they are open, it is at the cost of the water. However, transpiration is sometimes referred as necessary evil. But here, for this our purpose, we shall have to understand that what are the mechanisms taking place in the transpiration. There are physical processes as well as biological processes, especially the movement of stomata. In case of plant, there are two kinds of leaves: the dorsiventral leaf or the isobilateral leaf. The dorsiventral leaves are found in dicot plants or dicot crops. The isobilateral leaves are found in most important monocot crops. The isobilateral leaves possess stomata on both the surfaces, whereas dorsiventral leaves have on the lower surfaces. As we say here, is a cross section of the isobilateral leaf, and the stomata is shown on the lower surface of the leaf, which is referred as abaxial surface. In the diagram of the stomata, we can see that the stomatal aperture is surrounded by two guard cells, and guard cells are in turn are surrounded by accessory cell. The opening and closing of the stomata greatly depend upon the interrelationship of accessory cells and the guard cells. Here we also see that there is a diurnal variation in the stomatal opening. Stomates start to open from the morning, and it starts to close after evening and gets completely closed during night. There are certain exceptions in plants which are referred as CAMP plants or crassulacean acid metabolism plant, where stomata they open during night and remain closed during the day. This is a highly tactical strategy for conserving water under desert conditions. In the next diagram, we also see that there are conditions which are conducive for stomatal opening. For example, light, low carbon dioxide concentration, high pH, and potassium intake. It has been established through various researches that whatever the situation take place, one condition is very essential for the opening of stomata. When the turgor pressure of the guard cell exceeds the turgor pressure of epidermal cell, stomata will open. And when the turgor pressure of guard cell will be lower than the turgor pressure of the accessory cells or epidermal cells, the stomata will tend to close. Stomatal opening by any factor is accompanied by starch hydrolysis in guard cell, influx of K-ions, decrease in osmotic potential of guard cell, flow of water from surrounding epidermal cell, leading to enhanced turgor pressure of guard cell and opening. Stomatal closure by any factor is accompanied by starch accumulation, efflux of potassium ion, increase in osmotic potential, flow of water from guard cell to surrounding epidermal cell, leading to stomatal closure. In this part, we learned the basic principles of movement of water in soil plant atmospheric continuum, SPAC, and comprehended terms like diffusion, osmosis, plasmolysis, and imbibition. It was conveyed that diffusion is movement of solvent molecule from higher energy, chemical or water potential, to lower energy. Osmosis is a specialized diffusion through semi-permeable membrane. Water absorption takes place through roots in the hair zone and transported to vascular tissues, where upward movement of water begins. The ascent of sap occurs through many factors, including root pressure and cohesion tension in the shoot. It was followed that living components and non-living component of tissues form symplast and apoplast respectively. Transpiration is water loss from biological surfaces like leaves, and it is mainly through stomata, the tiny apertures on the foliar surfaces. Stomata show diurnal variation in their opening and closing movements. They open in response to light, humidity, and low carbon dioxide concentration, and close in dark. Dryness and high CO2 concentration. Stomata open when turgor pressure of guard cell is more than that of epidermal cells. Transpiration is a net result of interaction of physical and biological components. This part has applications in optimizing water requirement of crop plants and improving water use efficiency. Dear viewers, we appreciate and understand that this part of this course, especially the physicochemical property or soil plant water relationship or understanding movement of water in soil plant atmospheric continuum, may lead to very important gain of knowledge which has great applications in crop physiology. Thank you very much.